Hi everyone, and welcome back to another IBRACORP video. What a pleasure to have you all here. Thank you for coming in and checking out the channel today. A massive thank you to all the subscribers on the channel. We're at 25,500 subscribers. If you're new to the channel, please like and subscribe. It really does help the channel out. Thank you to our members who are supporting the channel as well by being a member, and to everyone in our Discord who's contributing to our great community. We really thank you as well. Something that a lot of people have been asking about in the comments, especially from our last video, which you guys seem to have loved, you know, seeing the new build, seeing all the different stuff we've done with it, provided your own ideas and ideas on chassis, and even feedback on the actual Silverstone chassis that we use. If you didn't see that video, be sure to check it out, because we went into some great detail on building a server with ATX components, you know, those consumer computer parts, and how you can repurpose them into, you know, I say this in quotation, but an enterprise server to serve you at home. Now on that server, we set up Unraid. And so today I was gonna take you through our Unraid setup, show you where it's at, what I've done with it, what I haven't done with it. And it's gonna lead us into the next video that we're gonna be doing in the next few days. I'm hoping in the next week it'll be out for you guys. But basically this video is just gonna chat about where our Unraid server is now. Now that I have it in a nice, calm space, you know, I'm not really messing with it at the moment. I'm happy where it is, and I think all of you self-hosters can agree. It's hard to find a spot where you feel happy with where something is and you're not messing around with it every day. But once you get there, you know, it's really nice to be able to say the server's just so self-sufficient. I don't have to mess around all the time. So let's just jump into it. So what you're looking at is our Osiris server. This is the guy that's living in the chassis that I showed you in the last video. So we're on the home page, and you can see we're on Unraid 6.12.3, latest stable release. Big changes from the previous Unraid versions, but I must say the transition was very smooth. A lot of new features and improvements, especially in the UI front. You can just see how clean it is. The ability to move stuff around has been incredible. So if I just uncheck that, you know, unlock it, you can just move stuff around, which I think is really beneficial. I think it's one of the very big improvements I've enjoyed out of this version from the Unraid team. So well done, guys. Really, really like what you've done here. And the ability to just switch them around on the fly is handy, especially for those who'd like to fine tune their UI. The benefit there is obviously huge. My server's not doing too much at the moment. It's not working very hard. I've only got one stream that's currently running, as you can see, but usually we get to, what do you reckon? I reckon we get to about 8 to 10 streams at some times, and this server doesn't even stress, honestly. It's not even stressed. So you can see I've gone with a very KISS approach. Keep it simple, stupid. Very clean, very simple. And I've been working with a client lately, guys, that if you don't know, we are starting to do some one-on-one work. If you need that extra help with something specific and you want to use our time, you can book us, email us at support@ibracorp.io, and we'll book a time with you and we can help you out. But I've been working with a client lately, one of our subscribers, and you know, I've helped him clean up his server a little bit, but he's got ways to go still. And I showed him my server just as an example. I'm not saying my server's perfect, but I can definitely show you my server from a cleanliness point of view. It's not too bad, right? It's pretty straightforward. It's pretty clean. You can see exactly what's happening on it without being too stressed and carrying a lot of baggage, you know, from your previous builds. And that's the best part about building a new server or rebuilding a server, is the ability to improve on what you had before and just realizing how much extra baggage you might have accumulated over the years. So this server's been up for 5 days, and that's because I recently just, you know, updated it. But otherwise, the server's been completely stable. I've had no issues whatsoever. Pretty happy with it. One of the main things I'll show you, if I just switch over to our main tab, is I've improved my cache capability. So I've got 2 terabytes of cache. It is much better in terms of the overall speed. I've found a good balance between how long it sits on the cache and how long it goes to the array. And having a 2 terabyte amount of space has been really good. I think I would probably recommend that moving forward. Maybe not for everyone, but definitely for me, that seems to be a good sweet spot. I haven't had to update any disks, but one thing I did learn in the process is shares settings. You know, I thought I knew everything about shares, which I obviously didn't, because one of my shares for the media location wasn't configured correctly. The automatically split directories setting wasn't configured correctly. So what it meant was my disk, you can see in this disk here, it's corrected itself now, but that got down to about 50 gig free or less actually, and it bottlenecked the disk. Now, that had ramifications down the line because I had a lot of other things that were trying to happen at the same time. Once I corrected it, it balanced itself out and started using the other discs the way they were supposed to. And we'll touch on that now. So let's go over to shares. And this is what shares look like in version 6.12. So they've done a great job of making things a little bit easier to understand, because previously in older versions, there was a lot of comments about how exactly does the share settings work? What does private mean? What does cache only mean, or cache yes, sorry. They've changed a lot of that around. So now just at a quick glance, you can actually see what's happening. So app data, storage, cache. Simple as that. We know that it's going to stay on the cache. That's what we've set it to. Backups, it's going to go on the cache first, and then it's going to go to the array. ISOs, it can be on the array and then move to the cache. Media, on the cache and then eventually the array. That is a much clearer way to look at it compared to the way it used to be. Now, if I click on app data here and we have a look, and you can see now in minimum free space, we can actually set a percentage. So previously it was just a size. Now it's a percent, well, which is really good. Then you've got your settings. So primary storage, they've changed that wording around. Like I said, primary storage, where do you want the primary storage to go? After that, the secondary storage, where do you want that to be? And the mover will do its thing. And then we also have more settings with the mover action. And if you're using the mover tuning plugin, you know, lots of updates there worth revisiting as well if you haven't been using it. We've done a video ages ago. I know it's a little bit outdated now, but a lot of the plugins that we're using in Unraid, I'll show you that here today anyway, what we're using for plugins. Users, nothing special there for us today, but if we go to settings, have a look at this. So we've kept it pretty slim here, pretty lean, and there's a reason for that. My methodology, which I explained in the last video, was this server is going to be just Unraid. It's going to be our NAS. It's not going to be our VM powerhouse. It's not going to be our container powerhouse. I don't want it to do any of that stuff anymore. That is gone now. If I want to run those things, I'm going to run them on a different server, you know, that serves a different purpose. Keeping it purpose-driven means I can focus on what it's actually supposed to do as its primary use and not overextend its capabilities. So something worth visiting is the Docker settings. I know a lot of people have commented on where you should probably keep that. And one of the best changes I've made is changing the default app data storage location. So on mine, I've set it to directly go to the cache. Now this avoids having to hit the share and letting the share do the work, deciding where it needs to go. I already know that the app data is a cache only location. So why not just set it as the default? I'll show you why that benefits us once we get to the Docker tab. Back in settings, maybe some other stuff might be handy to know is our user utilities. So we've got our backup and restore. Now the old version's gone. This is a new developer who's taken it on. Big props to them. And please support the developers here if you enjoy anything we'll show you. And you come into our plugins, and again, nice and clean. Not too much going on, not over the top. We're trying to keep anything that's, you know, up to date and is regularly being updated as well. Dynamics one probably doesn't need an update, but might be worth visiting and seeing if we can probably get rid of those as well. If I just scroll down, some of the handy ones I've found is Plex Streams. Pretty cool little plugin there. And it'll just display streams on your dash home here in Unraid. We scroll up a little bit more and you'll see some of the other Dynamics ones, which are very handy. And disk location I find very handy as well. Over to our Docker tab. Now you'll notice my Docker folders, my fancy Docker, you know, organization folders are gone. That was because it broke in the latest version of Unraid. I'm not sure if it's been updated yet. I'll have to revisit that myself, but I decided for now I'll just leave it off. I don't have that many containers. All I've done is organize them in order of, you know, importance and startup procedure, and I've kind of just left it at that. And you can see I really don't have that many containers, especially compared to a lot of people out there. All you can see is Nginx Proxy Manager, our tail scale for our VPN. We've got Cloudflare there running our tunnel. Plex, and remember, this is order of dependency, so I try to start them, you know, my networking stuff is coming up first. Next is Plex, and then all the stuff that supports Plex comes after. So we've got our media automation tools here, we have our Prowler, and then we have our requests, so Overseer, Tortuli, Plex Meta Manager, and a couple of the other apps there as well. Now, Notifier is probably one of the most important. And I have a big update on that, which is going to be our next video coming out in the next week, to help set up this, all of our media automation stuff, and Plex in one go. And it's going to be using the trash guides. Okay, so that's going to be our next video. I will show you all that and everything I learned out of having to do this again to help speed up the process. The other thing you'll notice is we're using the Trash Guide's recommendations, which we've done a video on before. Be sure to check that out if you haven't. But if you look at our shares here, you'll notice a bit of a trend. They all follow a very similar location. This allows us to take full advantage of our Trash Guide recommendations and the atomic links that we get. So by having them like this, our transfers are instant. As soon as a file has completed its download, it's instantly in the location that it needs to be for something like Plex to pick up. So you'll notice a little bit of a trend where they all kind of point in the same location here and there, and that's by design. I'll explain that in the next video though. For this video, something worth noting is, again, because we changed that default location, if you haven't done it yet, it's worth having a look into changing the app data location to the cache like I have. Now, if you go to apps and go to previous apps, you should be able to reinstall them this way. So if you hit that reinstall, it'll take your latest settings that you've used to install it and put it back on, okay? But just make sure you back up anyway, just in case. So anyway, there's our containers. Nothing too crazy going on there. Like I said, I'm trying to keep it real simple. VMs, I don't run any VMs on this server. We've got our app store, pretty straightforward as well. And you'll notice that a lot of new apps have been coming up under the IBRACORP repository name. That's thanks to Sternbear, one of our admins. He jumps in and creates these templates for us most of the time and gets them out to you guys to try. So big thank you to Sternbear. Really appreciate you doing that for the community. We'll probably do a video here on Xeraxi very soon, but we thought we'd put it out just for you guys to have a play with and see what you think. So feel free to drop some comments on that if you do have any tips on that one. We've got the Plex Streams plugin here showing up like I was telling you, so that comes up here for us, and it also comes up on our dashboard, so just here. And the other one is the disk location. So obviously you guys know we have a big chassis now, takes up to 20 disks. So I went ahead and started using this plugin so that we can keep track of where these disks are in our physical array. If I look at the front of my server, I know exactly what disk is in there. And if I don't know, it gives me some really cool abilities. If you go to tray allocations and I hit locate, what it's doing right now, flashing the read light on the disk, on the chassis itself, on the front. So I can actually just physically look at it and I know exactly where one is supposed to be. Now I know where one is because I've already set this up, but when you're first setting it up, it's not going to be in this order. It's going to be in any of these. It's going to look like this. So that just helps you locate them and organize your trays, you know? So if I had to pull something out, I can set the purchase date, how much warranty it's under, any additional comments, change the colors, and then go from there. So that's probably another one I actually highly recommend as well. The stats plugin, that comes from our dynamics plugins, and you can see it's pretty useful just to give you a quick snapshot of what's going on in your array. System stats as well, how that's handling things. Next is you come into the tool section here, you'll find some, you know, pretty basic stuff here. There's nothing too exciting. Most of the stuff's in the settings though. I mean, the Docker settings is really important. How much you set up here, what kind of format you want it in, you know, all very important stuff, the default networks. So yeah, guys, that's where the server is at the moment. It's doing a fantastic job. Our automation tools are doing their job, doing what they need to do, getting stuff on there nice and quick. Our array's managing itself pretty well. Temperature seems really good. I've got no complaints about the chassis, except one thing. And I did see some comments online on how to resolve it. It's a lot louder. I think it's probably self-explanatory, but being such a big unit, it does produce a little bit more noise. And being in an office that I'm actually working out of, which I'm recording this video in right now, it's a little bit louder. And that adds a little bit of a challenge if you're not used to it. I think I've gotten somewhat used to it now. The only time that it kind of shocks me is when I actually have to shut the server down and you realize how quiet it is without it on. Or if the temperature goes up in the room by a significant amount, like I've got the heater on, the fans will obviously spin up as well. And to address that, pretty simple. A lot of people have just gone and gotten Noctua fans that fit into the chassis, you know, brought that noise right down. And that's something I probably will do eventually. I just haven't got around to it. But that's where we're at with the server. I hope that answers some of your questions that I've been getting on the last video. Some people asked about electricity. I would say electricity costs went up, I would say 5% using this server chassis. But something very important to note is that I'm not using all my disks yet. So I'm not using 20 disks flat out. Okay, if that was the case, we'd be having a different conversation. But right now, I only have about 3 disks with content actually on it that's actively used. And at any one time, maybe only 1 or 2 of those disks are being used at the moment. But that'll change over time. The more content we get and it's spread over different disks, you know, obviously we're going to have a bit of a different problem. But hopefully that gave you a bit of an idea on how you can set yours up. And if you do have more questions, drop them in the comments. I'm happy to answer them for you. And like I said, if you want some one-on-one help, reach out to us and we'll book some time together and help you out. Maybe your server's absolutely perfect. And if it is, send us a message. I want to know about it because there's probably a lot of stuff we can learn from you as well. That's about it, guys. Hope you enjoy that. Like I said, I'm looking forward to pumping out a new video with Notifier. We're working with the developer Nitsua over on our Discord and chatting with him to get a new video on Notifier for you, which I think you'll all really enjoy. It's going to make your automation journey a little bit easier. The new format of the Notifier website is ace. And one of the best things that's just about to drop is the ability to not have to open any ports to allow it to communicate with your client on base. I'm going to explain all that in the new video, but keep an eye out. It's going to be really exciting. Until next time, guys, hope you have a good day. We'll see you in the next IBRACORP video.